position. How many people have been down the Great Bronx River? Raise your hand. When did you go down there?
Before the boat sank. It used to be a fishing boat.
That's right, the Great Bronx River Fishing Fleet below Westchester Avenue. Yeah, yeah. It hasn't been there now for a long time.
It's not there anymore? Yeah.
No, the last boat sank.
The British have plans to come down the Bronx
River. The British, not, they were going to go up. It was even worse. And after you see this show, you'll know why. All right, last year, after about 4 months of planning, we did the first scientific historical expedition down the river, the entire length of the river. And that means from Valhalla, it's a great way to start, right? You start from Valhalla, you don't end up in Valhalla. From Valhalla down to the East River, and that's approximately 25 miles. Eventually, 19 people were part of this. Now we're talking about historians, scientists, soil people, foresters, the two county parks, Westchester County Parks, Bronx County Parks, were involved in it. We had writers, professors of history from Fordham University. It was a great event. But as you'll see, there were some problems. So if I can have the lights. Now this gives you a general idea. Let me move this chair. It's a general map of the Bronx River. And if we look up here in the white area here, it didn't take as well as I'd like above White Plains, you see where there would be Kensico Dam. And that's what's really holding up the Bronx River water right now, Kensico Dam. And when you look all the way down, of course, the Bronx River goes all the way through the Bronx. And I want to make it very clear, the Bronx, or the borough of the Bronx as we know it, its name is only attached to this area we now live in. Other boroughs joined, and that means Queens, Staten Island, and Brooklyn, joined the city of New York, which was then made up of Manhattan Island and this section where we are today called the Annex District, also known as the 23rd and 24th Wards. 1898, they had to decide, everybody had a name. What name we're going to give to this area? And so they named it for the largest single geographical feature, a river. In fact, it's the only true river in New York City. This is a true river. This is not an estuary or a flooded estuary like the Hudson River. And of course, the East River and the Harlem River, they're not rivers at all, as you can well imagine. This is what's holding up the Great Bronx River waters, Kensico Dam. And of course, this is all part of the great water system, the pure water system that has made New York City famous. Since the Roman days, we've not seen this kind of pure water that comes down. Well, one of the first systems set up was called the Bronx Aqueduct. It still runs, but not into the Bronx any longer. And this system is all part of and part parcel of the great systems that still run through. You've heard of Water Tunnel 1, Water Tunnel 2, Water Tunnel 3, which is being built, and the Croton system, which this is part of. On April 19th, this picture was taken in 1999. And here we could not obviously storm the dam, so we began right next door in a little town that's called Valhalla. Now, you notice this is a shot particularly made. We're taken down. That's my kayak. Where it's a little drizzly, as you can sort of make out, and you'll notice a little bit more as we go along. This is the commissioner of Westchester County Parks, Sal DeSantis. And you'll notice that he's walking on the river. There was no water in the river. For the first 8 miles, we spent most of our time pulling the canoes. If you really take a close look, look at this. It's barely over the top of his boot. Look at that. We really were pulling the canoes. Luckily, it was raining. So by 2/3 of the day, and it was a two-day expedition, just to make it clear, 2 days to do the 25 miles. By the 2/3 of that first day, happily, there was enough water in there so that we didn't have to pop out of the canoe every, 10 feet. But it made for rather miserable conditions for those people who didn't like water. There were quite a few who didn't. And eventually, it might open up, and there you see a little section. The Bronx River itself is a magnificent river. The next time you go on the Bronx River Parkway, and you're not driving because I don't want you to crash, take a look. The river is truly a magnificent sight. And in fact, over 30 million people live within 50 miles of it. And it's very active in Westchester and becoming more active down here in the borough of the Bronx. And of course, anybody that now goes to the zoo, and we'll look at that picture in a little while, they always talk about that Indian, Irrawaddy. Well, they can't fool us. We know it's the Bronx River. And I'm just show that picture because you see those rain droplets in there? Very heavy rain. And so what was happening is we started to see the sewage outflows in different areas like Scarsdale, and, you know, then we got down to Eastchester. For the most part, the sanitary sewers have been corrected, but occasionally you could almost hear a flush and you see what came up. Okay, so that was in Westchester County. That's not true in the Bronx any longer, thankfully. The truth of the matter is what's called floatables. See all this garbage here caught by a bunch of trees stuck in the river? Floatables are anything that truly float. And that could also mean cars, as you'll later see, down in the river, a little further down. In Westchester County, it was filthy. In Bronx County, it was fine. So all the dirt that was being picked up was actually from Westchester County. And in fact, when we passed the Scarsdale Railroad Station, because remember there's a railroad coming up on one side of the Bronx River, which goes back and forth, the meanders back and forth. The Bronx River Parkway on the other, there was oil seepage from this from the Scarsdale train station, which almost asphyxiated us. I mean, it was really that strong. And the Parks Commissioner was like wild, the Westchester Parks Commissioner, calling into his cell phone, demanding that they clean this stuff up. And of course, I added, before it gets to the Bronx, which he didn't like that much. And here you see the train is actually to the right now, and the highway would be to the left. Now, the whole area here in the Bronx River is called the Bronx River Plain. And you should know that at the turn of the century, the Bronx River was a cesspool. It had something like 50 factories on it. There are no longer any factories, at least on the upper regions until you come to Hunts Point at the mouth of the river. There are no longer any factories operating on the river. And so we don't have that problem. Now, we do have sewage problem or overflow problems, but we don't have actual effluents that would poison the river and poison anybody in it. And in fact, Westchester County stocks what they call their lakes, which are all part and parcel. Here's a typical example. We probably popped out that first day. If I said 50 times, I'd be kidding. Probably more like 100. Every time, boop, you get up and you move along. Pull the canoe, pull the kayak. And in a lot of areas, you'll see a lot of refuse and garbage that has not been picked up. Again, this is just as you go down the river. We particularly picked this day, this day, because it's right before the foliage busted out. And we wanted to be able to see it. Now, what you've got here is myself and Commissioner DeSantis on the second day, the morning of the second day. Because we camped out in the Bronxville Boy Scout camp right along the shore of the river. Threw that in. And here you'll see a lot of these sewer outflows. That doesn't necessarily mean that every single one of them are, primary sewage. No, they can just be runoffs from the streets and from the highways. But a number of them were. And we were taking measurements of them. Now, there are something like 20 dams along the river. Some are a little larger than others. Some are huge, like we'll see in the Bronx. Some are only a foot, something of that nature. So we always knew we'd have to do a lot of portaging. Portaging is a French word by the French voyagers who did a lot of work in the upper Mississippi, then in Canada. And that's what we did, a lot of portaging. Pick up the canoe and carry it around to the next point. And then you'd find unusual things, like this should not be here because, I mean, this is a barge holder. I mean, why would you have something like this? And the answer is that it was actually a barge was brought up, and they were working on the railroad on the other side. And so they maintained the barge's position by using that. A little waterfall. This is an outcropping. You notice we're starting to see. This looks like a washing machine up here. You know, it had been some big rains about a month before, and that's a piece of a washing machine. Again, it's all Westchester County. Incredibly, as you come down towards the Bronx border, the New York City border in Westchester County, many of you don't realize it, but it's a squiggly line. And the squiggly line represented the old Bronx River. When the city again incorporated and they took over this section, and Yonkers and Eastchester decided not to join, and Mount Vernon not to join the city of New York, because there was a vote on it in 1892, they decided that, well, they'll use the Bronx River as the means of doing the boundary. Well, the problem with that is the river keeps moving around in its own valley. So you'll have sections that look like we entered the Bronx at 233rd Street, for example, and then all of a sudden it's back in Yonkers because it squiggles around. There were these incredible drawings and graffiti. You know, we haven't really seen much graffiti in quite some years because people finally realized, people in position to do something, realized that, you know what, why don't we just clean the stuff off? Then we'll catch them and we'll see who's doing it. And they did, and now you don't see very much of that at all. This is right at the border. And there are a lot of bridges we're going over and under, as you can see. And in sections it starts to widen out. And here's one of my favorite shots. Let's see if I can get this for you. Now, most people, when you talk about the Bronx River, actually know the river from this shot. Now, you see in the upper section there, that's the falls in the Botanical Gardens, right near, right up here. That's the falls that you see right near the Snuff Mill. And in fact, that was developed for the Snuff Mill when the Lorillard family, and eventually the factory company, had one of the first snuff operations and plantations. They were growing tobacco in the middle of the Bronx. And P. Lorillard and Company actually got its start in the Bronx, along the Bronx River. And they had their grist mill. Now you see I'm working my way down. This is an open skirt kayak. When we did this trip a number of years before, we didn't go over that dam, because that dam is about 4.5 feet, and it's in no sense cracking yourself. So we set some of our men down, and lo and behold, we cracked up some of the canoes. There are a number of big rapids there. We actually broke the canoe, meaning that try to imagine a canoe that's nice and flat and one that looks like it's 90 degrees. Not this trip, a previous trip. And in that previous trip, we got all of our canoes from the American Red Cross. This year, we got, except for that kayak, we got all of our canoes from Westchester County Parks Department. In that previous expedition, what occurred was we brought back all the canoes, and I was waiting for this call. Eventually, it came. Dr. Hermalyn, we want to talk about that canoe. It was a brand new canoe. I said, yes, I know. I've been talking to my fellow compatriots, and we've decided that we want to help you out. We didn't have any money, so because this was some years ago. I said, we've decided, yeah, your best decide, he said, you know, it cost us a lot of money, about maybe $350 for a brand new Grumman canoe at that time. And he said, cost us a lot of money, a lot of money. Yes, I agree. So what we've decided to do is we're all going to donate blood. The fellow's reaction was, that's not my department, we don't want your blood. And he never called me back, so we never used him again. So this time we made it down without anything. Now, one of the biggest waterfalls is one you rarely see. You really have to look for it. This is in the Bronx River area of Bronx Zoo, right below Fordham Road. And in fact, that's the bison paddock right nearby. So most people are walking down it's one of those outside pathways near the river. You're looking out towards the animals. You're not looking the other way. And it's this huge 2-foot waterfall. And in fact, it's a bifurcated waterfall. And there's another side of this onto our right side. It's almost like, Niagara Falls. There's two sides of it. Well, and we actually went down this middle part. We were able to bring our canoes down. And there's the other side of it. It's a substantial waterfall. Now, there's a boom. I bring this shot up because, see, this is an oil boom. There had been some oil slicks. Here, where am I? Here, over here. Okay, this is called an oil boom that holds any oil that comes out. There had been some problem, and so they put this boom in to collect it. It's very successful, and then they were able to draw it out once. So they just left it there in case there's any more problems like that. And I'm right beneath now what is a new park, which I don't have a shot of right now, but it's called the Waterfall Park, right south of the Bronx Zoo. It's this extraordinary little park, a very new park, and everybody sits facing the waterfall. This is not like, a fake one, Paley Park, which everybody likes downtown. They have the water running down this wall in the middle of the big city at Paley Park. But here we have a waterfall, a real waterfall. And right above that waterfall was where most people remember the Bronx River, because that's where you used to rent your canoes and your kayaks, your rowboats. And that was done for many, many years. That's where Wild Asia is today. The big building of Wild Asia. And how we finally come back, we're in the Bronx, of course, and we finally hit what we call our little graveyard of cars, because believe it or not, there are four cars there. That's just the one on top that you see, but they're actually all beneath us. How people were able to get the cars in there is really the question, because there's really no roadways nearby. It's like someone placed it there. It's very remarkable, actually, how these vehicles got there. And so they've been cleaning those out, and in fact, those are gone now. And so there are no vehicles left in the in there. Here we're going under one of the railroad bridges. So we'll work our way through. Now the river widens, of course, and it's all bulkheaded right up, and there's no greenery or anything like that. We're working our way down towards Hunts Point, which has a lot of action, a lot of dumps. Now this is the collection bin of metals, for example. And of course, they're able to get very large boats. And as the librarian was mentioning, the British soldiers during the Revolutionary War, in fact, Admiral Howe thought they'd be able to take the river and go up and attack the forces of the rebels. But of course, they couldn't. Once they get past this point, you saw what the river was like. It narrowed very rapidly. And if they hit it in April like we did, it was no water. And now we come out at the mouth of the river. And the mouth of the river into the East River is huge and very deep. And the channel there is very deep because they have fairly large-sized boats coming out. Those of you that remember the old Bronx fishing fleet, you go on a boat, you'd be coming out over here to go to Long Island. You'd make a left. And once you got past here and got past the Bronx, you'd make a left going towards Long Island, the bridges, you know, white stones. The problem for us is that most of us were inexperienced. I won't go that far. I'll say that they were surprised when the wind picked up, the current started, and they felt that it was very deep. It's one thing to fall in when it's 4 feet deep or 4 inches deep. It's quite another when it's 50 feet deep and you really feel the pressure. On the other side, of course, is Queens, that land that you see. And so most people say, well, the Bronx River is about 23 miles, but if you want to go to landfall, say where we were going, Clawson Point area, it's about 25 miles. And this physically was the most difficult. And you pull in over here. Fellow in my kayak with me is a guy named Bob Nolan. He works with the Bronxboro President's Office for many years. He always told me he loved doing this. I called him up, told him this is an opportunity. I want him to come. He then had his wife speak to me. She wanted to make sure I would bring him back alive. I guaranteed that he would come back alive, except the first hour that we did, this is now the second. About 4 o'clock now, second full day. Dawn to dusk, dawn to four. He fell in the water. He cut his head rather severely. He's bleeding all over himself, over the boat, everything. And we had to patch him up. Then I found out he wasn't eating. He was very hungry. He had decided that he was going on a diet the day before he went on this expedition. So I had to use a little Bronx force on him and shove some sandwiches down inside of him because he had to eat. He didn't realize he was really physically active. You pick up the boat a lot, that's some effort. And so by this time, he was in great shape. He couldn't wait to get home. He's like desperate. And then we're pulling him up. He was very thankful. And then he did his usual stuff. He spoke to the press. He was great at that. And to this day, he talks about it. His wife comes over and gives me a little kiss on the cheek. Thank you. This is the commissioner and the deputy commissioner of Westchester County, who was shocked at the size of this last part. You know, again with this big water, as we like to call it, and also at the state of the river and how terrifically clean the Bronx River was in the Bronx, and the reverse in Westchester County. And here is these. Yeah, a lot of work has been done, and it's continuing being done. Here he is. He helped out the commissioner. We had the Bronx commissioner, and you'll see him, Bronx Parks commissioner. We brought all the canoes out, and then all of a sudden you see a lot of people here now. And here's the Bronx commissioner, Bill Castro, right here. And he was with us on the first day. This is Roger Wines, Professor Wines of Fordham University. Then we had people taking water samples. This is Jenny Hoffner. She works with the Bronx Parks Department on the Bronx River project, which they're doing constantly, doing a lot of different programs. I mean, the river is so much better now. It's remarkable. And you see there, we have our truck loaded up with all of our equipment, our things, and we have a little picture of some of the people who took part, at least on this last day. Fellas in the back were following us just in case we went in, and of course, people did go in occasionally. The commissioner, the commissioner of Bronx Parks, Westchester Parks Commissioner, the fellow DeSantis right here. He fell in on the first day two or three times, and then he went to his mother's house to get new clothes. He was the commissioner. He had a car following him. He was all right. Because all of a sudden, he came back. He was dry. I didn't understand. How did he get dry? Everybody else was soaking wet. Oh, I went to my mother's house. I had a shower. So he had a grand old time. And that concludes the Great Bronx River Expedition. Now, what did we find? Well, as I said, we found that the river was in great shape, much better than we originally envisioned, and we were very pleased that that was the case. The other thing that we found is that it's very important that the Bronx River be in good shape, because the river itself represents the Bronx and Westchester County and anybody that comes through it. And the fact that the people have been fishing there and do fish there and do a lot of the watercraft are up in Westchester County, again, these lakes that you'll find, which are actually not, they're part of the river, they're just larger areas. And they're going to dredge up there, make the lakes a little deeper again. In the Bronx, we're putting back fishing piers down at Hunts Point. We're going to have a place where people can put their boats out again at Hunts Point. There were some articles about this recently in the New York Times. The fact is, the most unknown areas in the country are not in the Wild West. They're in our urban areas. And so, believe it or not, the Historical Society of Bronx County leads the tours going through these places. Why? Because no one knows about them, so we're the only ones who could do it. We'll bring people together. So we've been going around on all the rivers in New York City and waterways. We go to the lighthouses. We periodically move our way around the coastline, just to get a sense of what is today, and then talk about it like this, like now. Any questions?
Yes, we were always a bit puzzled at East Fremont Avenue and West Warren Square. The river is very, very narrow at that point, and we could never quite figure out what was happening there.
Well, first off, it's bulkheaded right there.
There was a tiny little waterfall about this high, and we couldn't figure out where the river was going, you know?
Well, it was going south. You could be sure about that. Well, it's bulkheaded right there. And bulkheaded, what bulkheaded means is that it's no longer natural vegetation. What they do is they literally put in either steel or wood planks, or, I mean, this is an old tradition. The best example of this is the Hutchinson River. Hutchinson River is filled in that way, so it doesn't look anything like a river. And it's very active, actually, up into New Rochelle, because they bring all the oil barges up that way. That's what feeds that whole area. Well, anybody's oil comes from the Hutchinson River oil refinery depository. Once you do that, of course, you've taken away any natural course of what the river or waterway would be. There's no, you know, there's nothing growing there anymore. It's not like you're going to have critters. The most productive areas, it turns out, were the old, what we used to call swamps. Now they're, you know, natural areas, they call them, and people are actually trying to put them back. And the Bronx was full of them. Bronx River had it at the mouth of the river, but not for many, many a year. Because by bulkheading it up, you don't have that ability to have all these critters just growing and living, and then other fish are eating it, and other crabs are eating it, et cetera, et cetera. So the answer to your question is, I'm not quite clear. You saw how narrow it was, and actually right where you're describing, it's not narrow at all. So I don't know what that means. You may be looking at a spur of another little stream. I have to think about what you said. Where did you say? Westchester Avenue?
East Tremont.
East Tremont.
And West Palm Square. That's right off course. Yeah.
Yeah, I had one of those pictures. One of those pictures is right there. It was the railroad bridge. I don't know. It could be that you're looking at a little stream that comes. Remember, the Bronx was dotted with streams and creeks, all filled in. Now they've been culverted. You put into pipes, they go underneath. Mill Brook, Rattlesnake Brook, I'm going to give a lecture tonight in Co-op City at Barnes & Noble. And, you know, what was that? That was all landfill. That's how they got land there. And, of course, Co-op City's always talking about the problems they have with things moving, because they all have pilings inside, because that really was a very rich, preserved area for production of stuff. That's what I like to call it, stuff. Today, it is 60,000 people and all those buildings. By the way, the most successful commercial venture in the Bronx in 50 years is River Bay Plaza. Have you been there? Who hasn't been to River Bay Plaza? Oh, what a treat you did. It reminds you of Fordham Road, 1965. Busy, active, everybody. It's all happening right there. Barnes & Noble. That's former site of Freedom Land. Barnes & Noble is there. That's where I'm giving my lecture. And they have one of the most successful. This is a little turn of that. But the manager of Barnes & Noble told me this story, which I'll convey to you. I'm very interested. We sell our books there. I'm very interested in their reaction to selling. It took so long to get them to come here to the borough of the Bronx. And the there's only two in Queens, one in Queens, and two in Brooklyn, and none in Staten Island. And then they decided to, let's see what happens. Well, they had such a great success with the Bronx, and one of the reasons is they have this is an A store, so that means they have the food service. And people, of course, love this. You know, you get a book, you sit down, you have a coffee, you have a donut, something, or a sandwich, or soup, and they read it. And in the Bronx, people return the book to the, like a library. Whereas everywhere else, like Manhattan, they throw the book on the floor.
Oh.
Couldn't care less. The Bronx is polite. How's that? And because they were so polite, they've decided, you know what, we can build more. Not in the Bronx necessarily, but a couple more in Queens, a couple in Brooklyn, and a couple in Staten Island, which the owner is actually from Brooklyn, so you could appreciate he finally understood that. But I think that's what you're talking about. You must be talking about one of those little creeks that you just see in the back end of it. But that's not the Bronx River. The Bronx River is very distinctive. It is not that narrow there. I mean, I would say it's maybe 50 feet across at that point. And then it really broadens out at the mouth to about a third of a mile. You know, right at the end there, it really is big. But just if you ever remember what it was like, did you say you took the Bronx, Queen of, what was the name of that? The Bronx Queen of the Sea? The Bronx Queen was one of them. The Bronx, what? Bronx Queen, yeah. And then you'd remember what it was like, but of course you probably were getting the equipment at that point.
Well, I used to live, you know, on Bronx Avenue right near Westchester. And I remember big tons used to come through, you know.
Up to where?
I don't know.
Up to Westchester Avenue. Yeah, well, they can't come up much further. That's it. Yeah, there were a couple of places there, but not where I showed you that big.
Fox Square Lawn View was right across from where we
were. I don't know that one. Well, I mean, clearly there's a demarcation. You could see where it was. It actually was wide enough up to where Starlight Park used to be, where the Cross Bronx Expressway is. In fact, that's where the vehicles are, the first vehicles we saw in the water, which are just the last ones. In the Bronx, about 20 years ago, it was filled with vehicles. Somehow, they got them in there. They were just dumping. That was the dump place for vehicles in the Bronx.
They used to stand on the 174th Street Bridge.
Right. Below. That's where that one, you knew how they got. Well, no, there was a way to get in. There was a station over there.
You knew how they got there.
Well, our belief is that the big trucks just came right up over there and just dumped them. They just pulled them because nobody was bothering. Nobody was looking. Nobody cared. And so taking them out is something. They got a huge derricks to come in there and pull these things out. Some of them are very difficult. And then further down from there, you know, now there are all ball fields there, right along the river. But they're situated in a way that the people who are probably playing ball don't even realize the Bronx River is right there. It's about a 25-foot embankment down to the river. And during the summertime, of course, it's all enclosed. Or was. We've been trying to cut it down a bit, make it much more palatable. So you can feel free. Next time you go to the Botanical Gardens and you walk along the Great Gorge, that's what that's called, where I showed you that kayak view. It's a magnificent place. Now, I'm not saying you have to drink the water or go fishing at the moment, but people do. People are doing it. And they seem to be surviving a bit. Yes?
I've canoed twice. First time with a friend, just myself and I in a canoe. I had an inflatable canoe. Mid-1980s, and I did it from the source to the mouth. And I put in about just around where the Taconic State Parkway starts, up around there.
Yeah, you missed the first part of our talk.
Yeah, I came right to that.
Yeah, that's Valhalla. That's exactly where we did it.
Right. And then
if they ever saw you, they would have arrested you.
Well, I wrote to them, I said, being it's a public...
No, they arrest people for doing this. That's the reason why we're doing it, to try and get people... Because, first off, government loves the notion of danger now. You know, oh, my God, it's dangerous, you'll sue. Well, the truth is, it is a natural waterway, and we should be able to have free access to it. But because of all the portage problems, they stop people. So you managed to slip through, which is good to hear.
15 years ago.
15 years ago.
Yeah, but I've canoed before, so I know how to canoe, and... the year after I went to, when Koch went, they had to celebrate the, I guess, the diverting of the sewage at near 233rd Street in the Bronx, and they had some celebration. So it doesn't dump into the river
right.
directly, so Koch was there.
Right, right.
But I had to do it in 2 days, and I think at the end of the first day, I put it at around 233rd, and then we picked up the next day, right the next day, at 233rd, and ended up in the East River.
Well, how clean was it, what, 15 years ago?
It wasn't bad. There were fish. 15 years ago, it wasn't
Well, they've been stocking fish, Westchester County, for 50 years. Every year, they stock fish. Rainbow trout, or brown trout, and I think perch, or something like that. So they've been doing that.
The thing I noticed is that people, you know, were just surprised to see someone in a canoe going
right.
down the river.
Right.
15 years ago. Just, they wanted to ask questions, how did they do it? It was a great canoe. I don't know, those canoes you might have rented or borrowed.
No, you missed almost all the show. That's yeah. what happened here. I can't repeat all these things, but that comes from Westchester County. Parks Department, those canoes. And in fact, when we were in Mount Vernon, one of the one problem that developed where there were a lot of kids waiting for the train, and they saw all the canoes. We had at that point, I think we had 9 in the water, and they started to throw things from the railroad. So some of these fellows from Westchester were not experienced in this kind of thing, you know, yelling back and. You know, and getting quickly through it, and they actually stopped and ran up to try and get them, which was ridiculous. I mean, it's, you know, the kids, you know, that's all the more reason they did more. I mean, it was like the worst thing you could do.
Jerry, can the public
no.
Join you on some of these expeditions?
No. No. The reason why you don't know about them is because we don't tell anybody until after we do them. I hate publicity, so I would never do that because it gets in our way. We do a lot of these things, and then we promote it afterwards. And as I said, there's federal money have come into the Bronx River upper reaches, because people who should see it did see it for the first time in their professional lives, and that's very, very crucial.
So this is a way of educating the people on what you're doing with these.
That's correct. That there is a thing called the Bronx River, and that you could have an expedition down the Great Bronx River, even if you walk it.
So you're saying now if I was to do the same thing and put it in Westchester?
They would see you. Yeah, they would not be too pleased.
They would order us to pull.
Oh, yeah.
And that's any river, hutch or sawmill?
Well, the hutch is nothing because you can't really do anything. The hutch was not really a problem.
The
hutch
went up as far as the Mount Vernon Ball Field.
Right, right. That's it. Only if you get in the way of the big oil, you know, the oil boats, the barges. Probably the next one we'll do, at least on the rivers, which are probably going to be very difficult. I don't know how much we'll be able to do, is the one along the sawmill. The sawmill is culverted in a lot of places, and the culverts are very small. So obviously, we can't go in there, so that's going to be a problem. For many years, there's been consideration to go down the Croton and actually go into the Croton system. But, of course, the water has been cut off, so it means we end up walking. And it's very dark. Did you ever hear that story of the Croton system? When the Croton water system was built, the Maid of the Mist, they had a rowboat, a little dory they called it, and the engineers went into it, about 4 of them went into it, and they did the entire tube, which is an 8-foot tube, an interior tube, in the dark, with torches, but I mean, it's the darkest you've ever seen. You can go up to Ossining, they've actually opened it up so you can go in inside of what it looks like. And it wasn't obviously filled to capacity because otherwise it wouldn't make it. And they popped out after 32 miles. So we've been thinking about doing it again, obviously without the boats, because there's no water in it right now. There's sections of it, there's no water. It's been cut in a couple areas. But the idea again is to see what it is, take pictures, all the pictures and video. We have a video of the river, obviously the first video that's ever been done on it. And so we have them all at the Historical Society available for people to see what it's like. And as the century ended, we searched it out, we found out what it's like. So all of you are bemused by it, but you know what? We did it, and you'll be thinking about this. The next time you read about the Bronx River in the newspaper, you'll see, you know, he said they went down that river. That's right. And that river is, by the way, always changes, and you know it always floods. Anytime there's a big rain, it always floods out of its banks. And it would have been great if it was... You know, a little more water, but that's not to be. You take what you have and you experience that. Anybody else?
It's hard to think that people are actually drowning.
Oh, yeah, well, there are deep areas.
After the rain.
Oh, sure.
I mean,
sure.
That's right. People are actually drowning.
That's right. people forget about natural occurrences. It's I'm not sure who to blame. I hate the idea of blaming anybody, but the thing that always bothers me is the weatherman now making like it's a personal weather, you know. And I promise you X number of degrees, and the weather is either too hot, too cold. It's never like, it seems like everything has to be between 69 and 72, that's it. Well, that's ridiculous. I mean, the idea that you can't live without air conditioning, well, I hate to bring up what we could do, or without computers, or without anything. So this notion of water being dangerous, of course water's dangerous. You know, you can't fool around with this. You can't fool around with storms. You hear a big storm is coming, you gotta batten down the hatches, get ready. And yes, people really do get in trouble with this, and periodically here in other areas, not in New York so much, but you know, where people drive off piers and floods and they're always drowning. Florida happens a lot. Former New Yorkers are driving around and they right into the, they know how to get out. And it's it for them, they're finished. It's weather is something to be appreciated, I guess is the way to it. And also this notion, I just saw Channel 4 the other day, had this, the weather woman there, got the name, made this whole thing about everything is changing and it's dangerous and it's so, you know, the weather has only been studied for 130 years? Just so you know. So when they say it's the hottest year ever, only in 130 years. And when we had a hot time last year where we were, it was cold actually in California. So it's not like it's across the board. There are things that are happening, but where our lifespan, larger though it's getting, is still, you know, minuscule in comparison. Now, real studies are being done where they go into these ice cores in 5,000 feet down in Greenland and in Antarctica. They've actually gone back 120,000 years, and they're able to see what the carbon dioxide levels are and what the oxygen levels are, any spores and things like that. And that's a study. That's real. So this other stuff is malarkey. Because for the most part, weather predicting is what? An art. It's not a science. It's an art. Because they don't have the whole system. Because when you look at a picture and the map, oh, in the New York area, I think they forgot the rest of the... Well, that we're near, you know, a great ocean and things occur. So the Bronx River should be utilized more. I think it will be in the next number of years. I think it is now. If you're interested in all the things that are happening, there is a newsletter that comes out from the Bronx Parks Department. You just call them up. You get the number from the they have a green book here, which is a New York City book. You call them up, and they'll put you on the list. They'll fax it to it, mail it to you. You'll be amazed at all the activities that are going on. They have a thing called the Golden Ball. Anyone hear that one? Good. Maybe I shouldn't say it. Well, last year they wanted me, they got a grant. It's just, talk about waste of money. They decided that they had an artist make a ball about 8 feet across, a golden ball, painted gold, obviously. And they were going to let it loose at the top of the river and just let it go down. And suppose that was going to be a big thing to make everybody become attached to the river again. Now, it has some... merits, very few, but it has a couple of merits, and I was requested to take the ball down, you know, keep moving, prod it down as it goes down. Of course, you saw how much I had to carry the boats, so I'd have to carry that ball as well. So we told them that not only do we not want that ball, but if it was anywhere near us, we would destroy it. God, this was not going to be, we're not going to have anything to do with this ball. So the week after, they were a little worried. So a week after, they tried to take the ball down. Of course, it got stuck immediately. Immediately. And so then they had to get people to carry it out. It didn't weigh that much. So they decided this was a mistake. And so they went all the way down to the areas where they could do it, the little lakes that I'm describing in Westchester County. They floated it in, picked it up, and even put it on a truck. They want to do it again this year. You might hear about it. It might be in the papers. You might see it. Because they want to get their money's worth out of the ball. Oh, good luck to them. But the point here is that there's more and more activity about the Bronx River. It is much cleaner. There's an organization like the Bronx River Restoration. They've been doing tremendous work on, and a lot of volunteers are helping out, cleaning up the riverbanks. It's really, it's as good as it's been for well over 100 years. I'll tell you that. The whole idea of the Bronx River Parkway, which, by the way, is the first vehicular parkway ever built in the United States, probably the world. And that's why it's got all those hairpin turns. It was built for 1920 cars. That's why it was that way. It's a magnificent, you gotta be calm about going. Actually, if you take your bicycle, when they close it, then you get an appreciation of what it's like. They close it in the summer on Sundays, I believe.
Just for amusement's sake, let me note that at one time my parents were in a car and somebody in the family said something very funny. And everything is weaving on the Bronx River. My mother starts laughing and it's summertime and her teeth pop right out of her mouth. And my poor father walks the line back and he got the teeth.
Yeah. Good man. Good man. That's a good story. He accomplished all on that one. Bronx River teeth story. That's very good. Very good.
You say the Bronx River is not an estuary.
Oh, it's a river.
The river. But it seems to me from the mouth up until East Fremont Avenue, there are tides, aren't there?
Well, it's in any river, but this is a river is something that has its own production of water. Okay. Where is that in the Hudson, for example? It's not until you get up to Poughkeepsie. And Poughkeepsie, by the way, the city of Poughkeepsie, draws its water directly from the Hudson River. And that's really the first city that can do that because that's where the line is. The salt line is about 5 miles below them. And that's where that is. And that's where it's a true river. From that point up to the, Lake of Tears, where it starts, it's a true river. The Hackensack up above there is a true river. The Passaic up above is a true river. But in the New York City area, it's only the Bronx that has its own water source. But of course, tidal action is always very big in anything that's near the oceans, you know, near the great seas. Anybody else? Okay, well, it's been delightful. Hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you very much. Thank you.